Let us pray. Dear gracious God and Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We continue to ask for your grace, your love, and your mercy on Mary and the children in this family. God, for this town who has been so gracious. God, they not only lost a husband, a dad, a mayor, but a friend. God, I pray that you undergird them with your strength and your love and your mercy. In thy name we pray, amen. You may be seated if you have seats. On behalf of Mary and the family, we certainly want to thank everyone for the outpouring of love that you have shown, the calls, the texts, the flowers, the food. It has just been overwhelming. I knew that everybody that had ever met Joel loved him, but I truly had no idea how loved that he was. Joel was born on April the 26th, 1953. He went to be with the Lord Sunday, December the 13th at 10:40 at Memorial Hospital in Gulfport from complications related to COVID-19. Joel was preceded in death by his parents, Joe, Doc, and Toxie Miles, his brother Jimmy Miles, all of Wiggins. He is survived by a huge, wonderful, beautiful, blended family. His wife, Mary Elizabeth Maples Miles, his son, Jody and Janessa Miles, and Justin and Haley Miles, all of Wiggins. He had bonus children, Tommy and Haley Havard of Houston, Mississippi, Jared and Haven Havard of Wiggins, Mississippi, Madison Havard of Wiggins, Mississippi, grandchildren, Kendall, Charlie, Jackson, Aiden, Ansley, Henley, Gary, and Ellie. Brother Russell and Sharon Miles of Greenville, South Carolina. Nephews Rusty Miles of Daphne, Alabama. Jeff and Pam Miles of Dothan, Alabama. Niece Olivia and Mike Zach of Melbourne, Florida. And a host of great nieces, nephews, and a dear friend, out of Mitchell. Joel's happiness came from his family, his service to his community. So many people have a desire, well, I'm going to grow up and move away and go to a bigger place and do different things. But Joel's idea of doing better things was staying at home, being here, serving the people that he loved and that he knew loved him. So I understand that he was instrumental in building this pavilion and having all the things put together, and people donated time and materials and effort, and at a minimum cost to the city. Little did he know, not long after it was finished, that he'd be lying in state. But the path that Joel has taken, we'll all take one day as we cross over. Our time on this earth will be limited.
I want to say on behalf of my mother and our family how grateful that we are for all of you here today. The outpouring of sympathy and love that you have shown has been overwhelming in the sense of how much that you loved the mayor of this city. I have written countless things and thrown them away because nothing seemed adequate enough to express how much we love Joel. But for those of you that know him, you know that Joel loved to laugh. It was one of his strengths, I believe. In a moment that was somber, in a moment that was sad, Joel would go to laughter. And oftentimes you wouldn't be able to control it because he got more tickled that you were laughing than he was. And I want to say this, and I asked my mom if this would be okay, and of course she said yes because there's a follow-up to that. I wasn't too keen on Joel like my mom was at first. It took me a minute to make up my mind. And man, it didn't take long. Joel loved my mom. My mom loved Joel. As time would progress, there would be a night about almost 2 years after my mom and Joel were together that I would walk in their bedroom one night and pile up on the end of the bed and start having a conversation. We were talking and Joel looked at me and he said, "Hey man, who would have ever thought 2 years ago you'd be sitting on the end of this bed having a conversation with me and your mom?" And we busted out laughing. And that story went on over the years where we would have something that would be funny or something that would be great or even something that was sad, and Joel would look at me and he would say, "Who would have ever thought 3 years ago or 4 years ago?" And that was kind of the thing that we had. Because you see, if you knew Joel Miles for more than 10 minutes, you realized that he was an easy person to love and respect. Solely because Joel was a person who did not love for the benefit of himself, but for the benefit of you. And for the last almost 7 years, we have had the great privilege to have Joel in our lives. And I will tell you this, I couldn't thank God more for the gift that he gave to our family. He loved this city. He lived for this city. And not to be called mayor was his joy, but to be able to serve as mayor was his joy. He believed in every part of him to put this city first. There would be times where we would all be together and his phone would ring and it would be some kind of problem. And he would handle that problem, whatever it was, and he would step back over to the table and mom would say, "Is everything okay?" And he'd say, "Yeah, it might have been a problem or something, but we got it taken care of. It wasn't a bother." And that's the heart of a servant. I'll never forget the first time that our blended family came together for Christmas. We were all sitting around, and of course, many of us all knew each other. It got time to eat dinner, and Joel said, "I'm going to say the blessing." And he started to pray, and as he prayed, he began to break and he began to cry. Because of the thankfulness that he had that we were all there together. You see, as much as he loved this city, he loved his family even more. He loved to be able to do things together and have fun together. He loved the grandbabies, and they love him. Now, you all most of the time saw Joel as a businessman, handling things in the city, or maybe you stopped by the feed store to pick something up and Joel was there. But what many of you did not know was after hours, he was a floor rolling, baby cut up, poppy. He would get in the floor and he'd play and he'd roll around and he would have just the best time, and he didn't mind getting on that floor and playing with the kids. You see, while all of you knew him as the mayor, you knew him as Joel, we knew him as Poppy. Because that's what the grandkids called him. And I will tell you this, as much as you could imagine, he gave every part of who he was to this family. Not to be seen, most of the time it wasn't, but because he loved. And so today as we stand here, I want you to realize that the city lost more than a mayor. The city lost more than a business owner. The city lost what is in my book an absolutely great man that I am thankful for the privilege to have part in my life. I want to say to Jody and to Justin, thank you for sharing your dad with us for the last almost 7 years. We've had a lot of laughs. We've had a lot of good times. And Mom, I want you to know that he loved you unconditionally, just like you loved him. One of the greatest privileges that I've ever had in my life was to know Joel Miles as part of our family. And Joel, who would have ever thought that almost 7 years later, we would be right here, right now. But I love you. We love you. And you will forever be missed.
How great thou art. How
Christ said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." He said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again. And I'm going to receive you unto my own. So that where I'm going, you know, and how to get there, you know." Well, there's always one in the crowd, isn't it? One said, "Well, Jesus, we don't know where you're going. We don't know how to get there." Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh unto the Father but through me." See, my brother Joel made his preparations years ago. And he didn't need to carry a sign, "Hey, I'm a Christian. Hey, I'm a good person." He showed it by the way he lived. The Apostle Paul made a bold statement one time. He was in a village, and of course he was a Jew, and the Jews had all their traditions and their festivals. And they didn't know anything about Christianity or evangelism and how are we supposed to act and how do we talk to each other. Apostle Paul said, "Watch me. Look at my life." And that's the way a Christian's supposed to act. Folks, I wouldn't want somebody looking at me every day of my life. Between pastoring a little church and a drug-infested community, we have a nice meth lab right across the road. Between working in the emergency room and working in the prison, sometimes the old devil creeps in. But Joel Miles lived his life. And you could truly say, if you want to know how a good man's supposed to live, how a Christian's supposed to live, look at his life. I've heard so many stories over the last few weeks as we sat in the parking lots with hospitals. And I have to say this because it's near and dear to his heart and to Mary's heart. People, COVID-19 is real. It's not a government conspiracy. This thing has to be taken seriously. As we sat in the parking lots, and I've always been on the other side, I had no idea. I really didn't. I had no idea what families went through and the stress and the strain of not being able to see a loved one, not being able to be there, can't even go in the hospital, sitting outside in chairs. It's devastating. But I heard so many stories, and there's two that I want to share with you because they both hit close to me. Joel was always doing things, as Tommy said, for other people. There was a young man who had a medical condition, who has a medical condition. His family were at their wit's end. They didn't know what else to do. They had tried everything they knew to try. And just like any of us, they were willing to do whatever it took. Joel just briefly heard about it. "I think I know somebody that can help you." Made a call the next week. That family's in front of the right people that they had no idea. And within just a few weeks, everything was taken care of. Taking a burden off of the family, Joel didn't gain anything from it. There was another young man that made two tours in Afghanistan. His training was to search, find, and kill people. He had fought drug cartels in Southeast Asia, rescuing children from sex slave trade, rescuing families out of slavery in the brickyards. This young man had lost part of his family, his house, his home. He lost all of his stuff. He was actually living in a barn behind my house. One day, this young man broke down. Couldn't take it anymore. Had a mental break. He asked his mom, he said, "Would you call Uncle Joel and Aunt Mary? Just ask them to pray." Because, you know, as church folks, we're good about saying thoughts and prayers, ain't we? Sometimes we have to put our shoes on. Put our feet on prayers. So Joel not only prayed, but he went to where this young man was at. The young man was totally broken. And he just simply held him as that young man cried uncontrollably. And they took him to a mental hospital in Meridian and put him out. And the boy's dad would have been there in a moment's notice. But he was in a mountain village in the northern mountains of Guatemala doing medical clinics and food distribution for people that had suffered greatly from a volcano. And that dad was me. And I was totally destroyed that I couldn't get to my son. But I had all the comfort. I was at least 2 or 3 days' journey from an airport. Just absolutely could not get there. But I had all the peace and the comfort and joy knowing that somebody loved my son. That Uncle Joel was there. And I knew he would do whatever needed to be done. Dr. R.G. Lee was a very famous pastor back in the 1900s, and that seems like a long time ago now. Most of us were born in the 1900s. He pastored First Baptist Church, Dallas, Texas. They had close to 1,000 when he started. By the time he finished his ministry, they had over 10,000. He was leaving a conference one day, and he noticed on the flight home there was a young theologian going to be sitting by him. And he said, man, I can't wait to see him. I can't wait to talk to him. I want to pick his brain. Dr. Lee got on the plane first, and a little later the young man got on, but he noticed the young man had a strain on his face. And the young man began to talk, and just a few weeks before, the young man's son had gotten sick with an illness very suddenly, and the doctors had told him there was nothing they could do. And as he had sat at the bedside of many other family members, now he's sitting at his own family member. And folks, if I've held the hands of many, many hundreds of patients that passed away over the last 36 years. When you hold your own family member's hand, it's totally different. But the young man said that the little boy said it was up during the middle of the day, and the little boy sat up in bed, and he said, Dad. He said, yes, son. He said, it's dark, isn't it? It's dark outside. And the man said, yes, son, it's dark outside. He said, Daddy, I'm tired. I think I'll go to sleep. He said, okay, son, you rest. And the little boy had a very specific way of folding his hands, and he'd place it on his head, on his face, and he'd lay on his pillow. And as he started to lay down, he sat up. He said, Dad? He said, yes, son. He said, I'll see you in the morning. And the little boy laid his head down on his pillow, closed his eyes, and stepped over into eternity. Dr. Lee said the young man turned his face toward the window, and after a long while, he looked back with tears rolling down his face. He said, Dr. Lee, I can hardly wait till morning. See, Uncle Joel crossed over, and in the morning we're going to get to see him. Sunday night at 10:39, a group of us were standing around the bed of my brother. And as we could see the electrical activity of his heart rate drop and the mechanical action of his blood pressure going down, Mary said, y'all might think I'm crazy. Well, I've known Mary all her life. She is a little crazy. I married one of her sisters, and I know how all that goes. She said, but Joel's favorite song, I have to sing it for you, for him. And she began to sing, oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display. And before she began to sing the chorus, to my right was a bank of 10 IV pumps. The doctor told us they had everything in their arsenal hanging. There was nothing else they could do. The nurse slipped behind the curtain and behind those pumps, and she was trying to silence the monitor. See, those monitors have factory settings, and they have highs and lows. And when it gets to a certain, when it gets to a 40 and a 30 and a 20, it's going to alarm. And she's trying to silence those alarms to give us that moment of peace. And as Mary begins to sing the chorus, the lady had silenced alarms, and she tried to turn loose of the monitor and back away. Let me tell you how awesome God is. God created that moment for her. Joel ministered with the last breath that he took. That lady was holding on to the monitor, and she wanted to turn loose, and she couldn't. And she finally gave in, and she stopped. She closed her eyes, and with tears pouring down her face. I don't know her. I don't know her name. I don't know what her problem was. But God dealt with it. God allowed Joel to be there on that shift, in that place, at that time, to meet her needs. And as Mary finished the chorus, All electrical and mechanical activity had ceased. She said, "Ricky, is he gone?" I said, "Mary, he's gone. He's crossed over." Then it hit her, and she sat back in the chair, and she said, "Oh, my goodness, he's not going home with me." Well, Mary, that wasn't completely right. He went home without us. He went home without us. I'm going to pray in a moment and dismiss us. As we dismiss, I'm going to ask that everybody in the park please stand or sit where you are. Allow the family to leave. We will do our procession through the city, and then just the immediate family will be at the cemetery. So this will conclude your portion of the service. We thank you for being here. I thank you for your love for this family that includes me also. I've just never seen people come together. In these times of division and turmoil, to see people come together and love each other and work for a common cause is overwhelming, and thank you. Let's pray. Dear gracious God and Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you for this day. God, I thank you for this beautiful weather you've given us. I thank you for this beautiful park and this pavilion. God, you prepared, just like you planted the tree that Zacchaeus climbed up in 100 years before he got there. You knew we'd meet this day. God, you're all powerful, you're all knowing, and God, your grace is sufficient. Continue to bless us, bless his family, these friends. God, continue to bless this town and send. I know already you have that leadership picked out for them, that they would love and he would love them the way that Joel did. In thy name we pray, amen and amen.
Come. call.